And speaking about Julia, so tonight she will present us continuous delivery with Jenkins, Docker, and as I said, with this based on exoscale infrastructure. You can follow her at Julia Matteo ODC, her Twitter handle. She's a very bright consultant, software engineer, and we did. We did quite some work with the presentation. I'm very happy to welcome Julia tonight. Mm.
Thank you. Okay. So, hello everybody. So as Ivan said, I'm going to present to give you a feedback of our experience in Ortiz building up an integration pipeline with continuous with the Jenkins, Docker, and Exoscale. So my name is Julia Matteo. I'm Ortiz consultant, as Ivan said. I'm a Java developer. I co-founded the G Duchess, a group trying to attract women to the IT world. So which is the goal of this presentation is to do continuous delivery. What is continuous delivery? It's the capacity of deploying in production at any moment. There is a slight difference between continuous deployment and continuous delivery. As I said, continuous delivery is the capacity to deploy at any moment to production, while continuous deployment is the next step to do this automatically. So this would be a classical integration pipeline. We will have a version control system, like SVN, Git, whatever. Then we will have the build phase, unitary test that can run in a Jenkins server or Bamboo, whatever. After this, between the unit test and deploy, we could have we could measure the quality of code with a tool like Sonar. Then we could deploy to a test server and launch some functional test using SOAP UI, for example. And after this, we could deploy to production. Each of these steps gives a feedback to improve the pipeline. So what is Docker? Docker is an open platform for developers and sysadmins to build, ship, and run distributed applications. So it is useful for developers because you don't have to imagine you have an application running on JBoss. You don't need to install it on your laptop. If you don't have it, you just have to run the container. And it's also useful for ops because you can standardize several environments. The difference between this slide is to explain the difference between Docker and virtual machines. So when using virtual machines, we have an hypervisor who has come responsibility to create and run the virtual machines. Each one of these virtual machines is going to have its own operating system, libraries and binaries running on it, and your application. On the other hand, with Docker, you have a Docker engine running on your operating system. On this Docker engine, we have Docker containers, which are going to share your host kernel and sometimes some operating system components. The isolation is going to be lower than with a virtual machine, but you are going to be able to share libraries and binaries. And please, as well as the kernel, as I've said, and this makes Docker faster, much more faster. So while a virtual machine can take even minutes to start, a Docker container takes seconds. So Docker works with containers and images. The key feature of one of the key features of Docker is its layered design. So you have several. You can combine snapshots of your file system. These are called Docker images. They are read-only. So this combination of your of Docker images. On the top of this combination of Docker images, you have your container, your Docker container, which is writable, and in which you can run your application. Docker is based on Union File System from Linux and Leaf container. So what does Docker offer in the context of continuous delivery? It offers more simplicity because your deployment unit is the container, which has everything on it. You can also combine containers, as I will explain later. It's faster because, as I said, we work with layers. Each time you have to build or to upload your image to a Docker repository, for example, you are going just to upload the delta image, the image that was modified. It's robust also because even if it's a quite new tool, you will have less scope of error than using deployment scripts. Most of all, if you have different deployment scripts per environment. Other advantages are that it facilitates rollback, because doing a rollback with Docker consists on stopping your container and running the other one, basically. So this is the infrastructure we built up in Ortiz. We have two nodes of Exoscale. One of them contains the GitLab repository, the Jenkins server, the Docker private registry, a sonar, and a Nexus. And on the second node, we are going to deploy our web application. In the first node, we have 5 Docker containers running. The web app we deployed, it's pet clinic from Spring. It's a really simple application with a database in memory. So we would have the developers working. Once they take in to the GitLab repo, Jenkins will detect it and will launch a job to deploy the code on Sonar to measure its quality. Then we would deploy the artifact in Nexus. This is classic. And here we would have the new steps. So I use the Docker Publish plugin to build the Docker image from a Docker file, which is in our project, in SVN or Git or whatever. So the Docker Publish plugin is going to build our image and push it to a private Docker registry. Then we are going to use the SSH Jenkins plugin to connect to a remote node and execute some commands on it in order to deploy our web app. And now I'm going to show you the Docker Publish plugin configuration. It's really, really simple. The only mandatory field is the repository name. In this case, I specified the IP and the port because we are using a private Docker repository. It's a way to do it, as I will explain later. This slide it's just to explain a small trick. Actually, as we are running Jenkins on a Docker container, and we use the Docker publish plugin, we have to run Docker commands on a Docker container. This is not possible out of the box. We have to use a Docker wrapper. And the way to do this is just to import this Docker file in our Jenkins Docker file. I think it's a person from a committer of Docker who made it. So the next step, just a slide to explain how to create a Docker private repository. So if you have if you can publish the image of your project on the Docker public hub, you can create your own Docker private repository. As I said before, you just have to prefix the name of your image with the IP and the port of your Docker private repository and pull and push as you would do with the public Docker hub. And the next step would be the SSH access to the remote exoscale instance. This is not a new Jenkins plugin. We just have to add the remote site to the configuration and describe the commands we want to execute in remote. So in our case, once we are connected to the instance in which we want to deploy, we pull the image we have just pushed on the Docker private repository. We stop the container in case it's running currently. We remove it and we run the container from the image we have just pulled. This is another trick. When using the SSH Jenkins plugin, we have to use the SSH agent and our keys. An easy way to deal with this is to create a volume with your SSH agent, the SSH agent of the host machine in which the Jenkins container is running. So this is just to facilitate the work with SSH keys. So in the first parameter, minus V, we map the SSH agent directory of the container with the one of our host. And on the second parameter, minus E, we declare the environment variable where it is located. So now
probably it's probably because with this exoscale you cannot do password access in the VM.
Yes.
So you're trying to pass the keys from one node to the other.
It's from the host of the Jenkins where we are running the Jenkins container to easy the access to the second node. Actually, I don't remember, but I know I had a lot of problems to start the SSH agent on the container, to add the keys. I didn't find that easy, and this was a nice shortcut. So now I'm just going to show you that in live. Oof. I think my internet connection is not really good. Maybe I can just show you the maybe I can just show you the logs of Jenkins while running the job, the Jenkins job before. so here we are running the unit test of Spring Pet Clinic. here we are using, it's the step in which the Docker Publish plugin builds the image from the Docker file of the project. So, this is the Docker file of the project. It's really simple because we just use the Jetty image and add the war to the web apps directory. and after that, it publishes, as I said, the image just built to the private Docker repository. So, as you said, as you see, it skips all the push of all the images of the layers that are already in cache and that have not been modified. So it's really fast. The first time it takes more time, but next is really fast. So now there it finished the push, and here the SSH plugin starts. We execute these commands on the second exoscale node. So we do a pull, stop, here. Here it's pulling the image from the repo and there it runs the container. Well, this is a fake demo, but you would have the web app deployed on the second node. And here I added some slides I found useful because this is a really simple application. We just have a container and a war to deploy, but in case you have a database, maybe a search engine, you can combine your containers using basic Docker, a basic Docker command line like in the first point. With the parameter link, but you can also use Docker Compose, which is also called fig, that's a text file, fig YML. You describe your configuration, and you just have to invoke fig app, and this will deploy the containers linked. So this is a test environment because each time we deploy, we interrupt the service. When deploying to production, we can do this. There are two classical ways of avoiding this: the canary releasing and the blue-green deployment. So in the blue-green deployment, we have two identical production systems. Imagine we have the current version in the purple squares, and we would deploy the new version to the green ones and switch the router, let pass the user request to the second one. So this would be a deploy all at once. We are really sure the new version works perfectly and there won't be any trouble. And the canary releasing is more incremental deploy because we have more or less the same infrastructure. We have the two identical production systems. We would have the current version on the purple ones, and we would deploy the new version to the green system. And we would pass little by little the user request. We will redirect them to the new system until we are sure that it works perfectly, and we switch. We redirect all the user requests.
Can you the router is a load balancer or not?
Ah?
The router is a load balancer?
Because
it seems that the first slide was like both cases a load balancer. In the first, you balance by session, new session goes to the canary, to the second one. And on the other one, you unregister the old environment and switch to the other one or something like that?
Actually, I think it's a router. I think you can do it also with a load balancer, but I'm really not an expert. It's just the theoretical part.
Yeah. This is the way. So you are currently using this in production. So you have a router or a load balancer, and you have something to trigger the switch.
Yes, you can do it manually, or you can do it automatically. Well, I imagine you do that manually in the canary releasing. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Just a question. What I don't understand is like, how do you do to pass from one system to the other one? And for me, the problem is the database. How do you do to pass from one system to the other one and synchronize all the data from one system to the other one? I mean, like, at one time you have some new data into one database and some new information to the others, and then how do you...
So the session need to be synced, otherwise the user lose the connection to the... You need to keep the status.
Yes.
The data need to be synced between the two environments somehow, so you can have a MySQL application between both.
Yeah.
This is one part of the problem. The second part is the session, because on the you need to keep the session in memory. You have the session of the user, which is connected. So if you don't sync the session, the user will be disconnected from your application.
Yes.
So you
you need to have so the balancer to keep the session, and if you are already the session is linked to another.
Yes. This is the second slide. The second slide, the user slowly, session by session, when they establish a new session, they move to the new environment. That's the second slide. But the first slide, you have a split brain.
So you need to synchronize.
So you need to sync the session is on the GBoss side.
Yeah.
On the GBoss side, after you still need to do it on the database.
And for the database, it's not possible to synchronize to the database.
Yeah,
but you need to have one database and to develop some script
to make it master.
Yes. Now all script need to be compatible with both version for the whole database.
Yeah, the port compatibility for the DDR. Yeah.
I read also that there is a way of dealing with transactions, like duplicating the transactions in both systems, but I don't know the details. I think it depends on the implementation, and I'm not an expert.
Are you also using Docker for the production part?
No.
Or is only for the quality?
Yes. Yes. Well, more questions? No?
I think you should try Mesos.
Yeah, I heard about
it. You're pushing your app through SSH with basic bash commands in that Jenkins job.
Mm.
You should really talk to a Mesos cluster so that you can talk to the Mesos API, passing a description of your application with your containers and so on.
Mm.
You just hit that API instead of doing a SSH.
Mm. I heard also that Ansible was a nice solution. Ansible.
Yeah, but
nothing to do with this. Ah, okay.
Is it a good idea to use Docker on top of Mesos? Because it's container inside a container. Because Mesos itself is a container.
Oh, no.
they have deployed basically, you have frameworks in Mesos to schedule tasks, and one of them now they can schedule the containers. So, container Docker container are first class citizen to execute things in Mesos. So the Marathon framework, you can just pass a JSON file that references an image in your repository, and when you tell Marathon, hey, run this, and it's going to do the pull and run it. Yeah, it's not embedded within an executor.
Yeah, that's where I thought Mesos was getting as well. Underneath, there's also some sort of containerization.
Okay, so thank you.
Is it possible to try the live demo?
I don't have internet. I have problems with internet.
We tried the website, you have to register, and for some reason it doesn't work, the registration. Well, thank you, Julia.